Good morning, y'all. This is the men's Bible class, and I'm going to invite Todd up here to say a prayer for us and open us up.
Thanks, God. Y'all join me this morning. Lord, as always, I thank you for this beautiful day that you provided for us, and thank you for the rain you sent our way, Lord, to refresh everything that was turning brown and in need of moisture. And Father, we just thank you for that. Lord, we know that I'm a flawed individual. I'm a sinner. I'm thankful that I can come together and fellowship with those that are struggling on this side of heaven, Father, that we come to you battling many things, our sins, our addictions, Father, and all those things that get in our way, our stumbling blocks. And Father, I pray that as we keep looking towards you and sticking that word that you give us, that we feast on it and we fill it up to overflowing, that we may overcome those things that get in our way this side of heaven, Father. Because I know that we're going to get a new body when we get to heaven. I can't even fathom that, Lord. I'll have good knees and a good back, and I'm ready for that. Lord, and I thank you for the folks that have intervened in my life, that have influenced me on the good side, Father. I lift their families up to you, that you just fill them up to overflowing this morning. And those, Father, that are speaking your word, may they be lifted on high this day. Father, we've so many things are going on today. We definitely need you. And as we come here today, Lord, I was reminded this morning in our talk that we had bright and early this morning, Father, of who you are and who I am. I am a child of God, Father, and we can overcome this morning. So, Father, we thank you as we come here together to fellowship and sing songs and hymns and praises, Lord. And I'm kind of envious of those that have gone on ahead of us, Lord. And we just thank you for their grace, your grace and mercy upon each of us. Well, Lord, we love you and we praise you. We lift it up in the precious Son, Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah.
All right, good morning. I'm filling in for Joe this morning. He snuck off to hang out with another flock.
Uh-oh.
Nerdy dog, but we'll miss him. In the meantime, we're going to make do. He left me in charge, so I'm not a man of many words, and I got a buddy coming up here to speak, Mr. Jimmy Drinker. And I'm going to turn it over to him and let him have it. And then if there's time at the end, I'll throw in my 2 cents. How about that? So come on up here, Jimmy.
Praise God.
Good morning, y'all.
Good morning.
Whenever Joe asked me to speak, I didn't hesitate none. I said yes, because I love to lift and glorify the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. For I know from which he brought me from. I've never done anything on the radio before, so y'all just have to bear with me a little bit. But I just love the Lord this morning, and I'm going to thank y'all for the opportunity to be here this morning and for y'all to listen. And I hope y'all really receive something out of this. I thank and ask the Lord what to do. And that's just, he just spoke to my heart, and he said, well, why don't you just speak on Psalms 23? You know, we all know it. You know, he is our shepherd. You know, and if we really trust in the Lord and knowing that he is our shepherd, what should we want? He supplies us all our needs.
Amen.
Even though that there's many times that we want something, but the Lord knows exactly what we need. What we want may not be what we need. Even though, well, you know, he's going to give us a need, but we want this. That's the flesh, is always wanting something. And if we keep the flesh under subjection until his holiness and his power, he's going to see us through everything. So I just want to speak a little bit on Psalms 23. And I'll probably do a little demonstration here on some of it. And I moved here about 2 years ago from Northeast Texas to come down here to help Brother Mike Henderson out with his church. I've been ministering there at the camp meeting that we have every year down there for the last 20 years. And I moved down here just before he got real bad sick, where I could help him out and take some of the load off of him. And I've been here ever since. And I believe this is where the Lord been wanting me to be down here. I had my heart set on Tennessee. I used to do a youth camp meeting there in Tennessee. And but he took Tennessee out of my heart and put Junction on my heart. So I come down here to do that and help with Brother Mike Henderson. I go by the ministry name of an evangelist that I am. It's Elijah Moses Ministries. And That's the thing that the Lord gave me here some years ago, and I asked him why. He said, well, that's what he wanted, so I'm not going to argue with him. That's what he wanted me to do. But Psalms 23, if you just got your Bibles, you want to turn there. It says, "It's the Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in the green pasture. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yes, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, thou comforts me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, and my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." This is a psalm that David wrote. You know, David was a little old shepherd boy. You know, and as he was watching over his father's flock and teaching him and taking care of them, he realized as just being a shepherd boy and watching his flock that he was the shepherd of the flock, but he also realized that the Lord is my shepherd. He watches over me as I watch over these flocks. Whatever happens to the flock that I'm the charge of, I am responsible for these as he is responsible for us. Now, he's not responsible for our actions to which we do. But he's the responsible for what he does in the Lord. Now, there's a lot of times that we'll get outside the Lord and we'll go do something that we're not supposed to be doing, and that comes back on us. And it also, as people knows us as we're walking in the Lord, that they also looking at our lives, and then when we get out of our walk with the Lord, you know, that it kind of brings a reproach back upon him. But David said here, he said, "The Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want." You know, a shepherd man has a lot of things. He has a little old staff in his hands, a rod and a staff here in his hand. Of course, it's something like to this here, but it's a little bit longer, a little bit bigger hook. And he carries it around with him, walks with it. And he's got a rod. Something according about like this here, except it's just got a little bit bigger head on it. And he has that down on his side with a horn of oil that he carries with him down here on his side and hanging down. And whenever the shepherd sees a little flock, sees a little lamb or something get in trouble, he'll reach over there with his rod and tap that thing, his staff, and tap him to get him over there. Or if one's acting up, he'll reach out there with his staff and pull him back in. Instead, you know, he said that the Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. That's where the sheep are. You know, the sheep said that the Lord said that my sheep will hear my voice. And other ones he will not tend to. Whenever that shepherd calls his sheep, that sheep comes round. And whenever he walks forth, he leads his sheep. He doesn't drive his sheep, he leads his sheep. Now those that drive their sheep is not a shepherd, they are a butcher. And not a shepherd. And he says here still, he says, "And he maketh me to lie down in the green pasture. He leadeth me beside the still waters." When a shepherd takes his flock from pasture to pasture, and whenever they're in one field and they just about got all that eaten up, when they begin to do, it's nothing like us. Whenever we're eating in the Lord's table, and just about the time it starts getting dry, and we start getting dry and worried about something, we start panicking. Lord, what am I going to do now? Where's the Lord at? But the Lord is always there with us. He's never too far away from our next call out to him. He's there. And whenever he leads his sheep into another pasture, it's green and it's flourishing with water and stuff, and they have a little pool where they can go down there and get the water. And that's the way Jesus was. He leads us from glory to glory.
Amen.
He doesn't lead us to trouble to trouble. We ourselves lead ourselves from trouble to trouble.
Amen.
But whenever we put our trust in the Lord, he will lead us to glory to glory.
Amen.
He And he feeds us and he waters us with his word. His spirit comes upon us. Now there's times that the spirit of the Lord will come upon us so heavy and so strong that we don't know what to do with it. And sometimes we want to shout, sometimes we want to run, sometimes we want to jump and just spin. We don't just because it's our reaction to the spirit of the Lord. We got to understand and know one thing: whenever the Holy Ghost comes upon us or the Spirit of the Lord comes upon us, we feel the Spirit of the Lord, but it's our flesh that reacts to that Spirit. He said, "He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake." And whenever a shepherd takes his little flock, he's going to lead them into the path. He's not going to direct them into the path of where the wolves and the lions and the cowards are. It's the same way as Jesus is with his little flock. He's going to lead us in that path of righteousness. And whenever we get out of the way, our conscience or the Holy Ghost that's in us, he's going to reach over there and tap us. Don't do that. You get back over here on this way. You're wrong. Look, you're right. One of the devil's going to reach over there and grab it. It said, "Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil." There's a lot of times we ourselves walk, and the Spirit of the Lord will try us and test us. And we're thinking that we're walking in the valley of the shadow of death. Lord, where you at? I don't feel you anymore. Father, we're over you. It seems like your prayers are just falling or hitting against a brick wall. It can't go nowhere. But he said he leads us into that. "Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for thou art with me." And that's what it is. When we know that the Lord is with us, that rod and that staff, it comforts me. Whenever a shepherd leads his flock and they run up to a sage and they can't seem to get around it, his staff, his rod that the shepherd carries here, he'll take that rod and he'll start beating a pathway through that sage. Now the sage they have over there has got big long thorns on it with a little old flower tip at the end of it. And whenever a lamb or a sheep gets up against that sage and it pricks them, it develops a big sore on them. It just starts being infested and starts getting a big sore on them. And that's why that shepherd has that rod in his hand. Whenever they run up to that sage, they can beat that sage down and make a way. "Though I walk through the valley of death, I shall fear no evil." He makes that way through that path of righteousness there. It keeps all this stuff off their sheep. That's the way the Lord does us. If we walk with the Lord, he's going to lead us into the path of righteousness. And no evil thing can come against us. "Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, and my cup runneth over." A shepherd takes his sheep from one pasture to the other pasture. He prepares a table before his sheep. He said, in the presence of my enemies, though there be lions, wolves, whatever may be there in that pasture, that shepherd's always sitting there watching over his sheep. And whenever he sees one of the enemies trying to attack his little lambs, he's going to go over there and protect that lamb. He's going to fight that little lamb off. Whenever one of the flock of our congregation is sick, the pastor should be the first one to go to that one that's sick, the one that's hurt, the one that's in the lane, and talk to it, work with him, and carry him. You know, a shepherd, whenever he has a little sick lamb, he'll leave the 99 and go to that one that is sick. And he'll nourish that little one. He'll minister to that little lamb, whatever his needs may be. He'll minister to that little lamb. And that's what a pastor should do whenever one of his lambs. He don't have to wait for the congregation to go. Well, I'll just sit right here, brother so-and-so or sister so-and-so will look to it, and I don't have to. That's a hireling. I'm sorry to say, but that's a hireling. He cares not for the sheep because he's a hireling. I'm sorry.
Amen.
But that's what the Bible says. He's a hireling. I'm going to let so-and-so do it. Well, so far in my 20 years that I've been with the Lord, I have never met brother so-and-so. I've never met him. Never met him. I was with a real good friend of mine this last week that he was on this earth. And I stayed there and ministered to him all the time. Whatever need he had, I was there with him. Friends come in and seen him and talk with him. A lot of them wanted to pray with him and stuff like that, but he was the type of person that said, don't push this on me. And that's the way a lot of preachers want to do. They want to push something on somebody. You know, the Bible says, those that are mine I have not lost. And no one can pluck you out of my hand.
Amen.
For those that the Father has given me, I have lost none, except for those that are the sons of perdition. Jesus knows who is his sheep and who's not his sheep. He said there that he's going to separate the goats from the sheep. He said he's going to put the sheep on his right hand, he's going to put the goats on his left. And he's going to say to those that is his, says, come and enter into that which I have prepared for you. And you that are on the left, depart from me, you workers of iniquity, I never knew you. Said, but though, Lord, we prophesied in your name. We've done a lot of many works in your name. We've done this and we've done that. So he's going to look at him and say, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. Because you've done it for your own glory and for your own self. You didn't do it for me. You didn't give me the honor. You didn't give me the glory. And I'm sorry to say, there's a lot of preachers today that's doing the same thing.
Yeah.
I want to glorify my Lord and my Savior.
Hallelujah.
He anointeth my head with oil, and my cup runneth over. Now that shepherd has a little horn of oil that's hanging down by his side. And whenever he walks around the sheep around there eating, there's flies that come up. We was talking about the old horse flies this morning, about how they're getting on the calves and then the cows and stuff, and starts irritating them and biting at them and getting around their eyes and start eating and all. He has to go down and spray those little cows and them calves down with the spray to keep the flies off of them. Well, that's what that shepherd does with this horn of oil. He said, he anointeth my head with oil. Whenever the flies gets on the little lambs and the sheep's face, the first thing they want to do is go to their eyes. And they start biting at their eyes and their heads. And then they start putting the sore in there. And then they put their little larva in there. And then the first thing they start going and growing, and it's going to infest them, is that little lamb, that cat, that little lamb or that sheep is going to die. So whenever the flies and all starts biting on them little old goats and all lambs, he'll take that horn of oil and he'll open it up and he'll pour a little bit out. And he'll anoint that sheep with that oil on his face and up around his head and all that to keep the flies off of him. And that's the way the Lord is with us. You know, Paul said, put the helmet of salvation upon him. Why did he say that? It's because the first place the enemy attacks you at is right here. Right there. He puts thoughts in your mind. And if you start listening to that thought and start entertaining that thought, the first thing you're going to do, you're going to start acting upon that of what you thought. We all have that. We cannot say that not one time have we ever had an evil thought to pierce into our brain. We all have that problem.
That's right.
But whenever we come to the Lord, And we probably, we said, Lord, I don't want this thought under me. Satan, get thee behind me and under my feet where you belong. You have no right in the house or in the temple of the living God. It's not the building to which you worship in. This is the temple of the living God.
Amen.
Whenever he comes back, he's not coming back for a building. But he's coming back for his people.
Hallelujah.
This is the church here. This is the church.
Amen.
And he notices our head with oil and our cup runneth over. What is the grace and the mercy of the Lord? Always there with us, and whenever we do boo-boo and make a mistake, the first that we apologize, we repent to it, our cup runneth over. And we know that we've been forgiven. Our cup runneth over. It's merciful, gracious God that we live. But back whenever, before I got into the Lord, I come up in Abilene, Texas, upon the streets whenever I was 9 years old. I've seen a lot of bad things. I had a lot of bad things to happen to me. And I got bitter and angry and resentment. And whenever I seen somebody with a Bible, I would kick it out of their hands and throw it away. Because the hate that I had in my heart, the hate that I had. Somebody tried to talk to me about the Lord, the first thing I'd done is push them back or kick them or punch them. And told me, get away from me with that lie. Walk away from me because it's going to ruin your life. Not knowing any difference. But whenever the Lord started dealing with me, and I said to myself, there is no God. It's for people like you that are weak, that has to have something to worship, to a deity to go to. There is no God. But in 1993, the Lord started dealing with me real hard and heavy. And I'm going to say this whether you believe it or not. Whenever I come to the Lord, I've got a letter from the school where a whole lot of things happened to me. I'm not going to say it all, but a whole lot of things happened to me. And at the last day of school, no matter what we did to my son's teeth, it just kept getting worse and worse. And I didn't have the money for the dentist. It cost so much. And whenever the Lord started dealing with me, my little foster sister, about yay high, I'd hold my hand out there, she could walk up underneath my arm. Little old stick of dynamite. She'd sit up there and look at me all the time. She was keeping my son. She's sitting up there looking at me all the time. She said, Jim, there's a kelp meeting going on down in Junction. I think you ought to go. I'd cuss her out and chew her up one day on the side, down up one side, one the other. She'd just stand there and look, said, you're going to go. You're going to go.
Praise God.
And I'd draw my hand back. She said, you can't hit me. You're going to go. Well, so much happened to me and during that time, and so I went to the camp meeting, and I got a letter from the school right there at the end of the year. Said if that boy comes back with his teeth in the shape that they are, we're going to file charges against you and take your son away from you. And that upset me so much. Oh, that hurt me. I raised my son since he was born. Been a drunk and an alcoholic. And that hurt me so bad that I don't know what to do. I was down to my last point. For 6 long months, I took my gun off my gun rack to put it to my head and to pull the trigger. And I'd hear a little voice speak to me, said, one more day. That's that anointing of the Lord to which I'm talking about that I didn't understand at that time. So I went to the camp meeting, and I met the Lord there.
Hallelujah. Yeah.
And there at that camp meeting, my son got his teeth filled. Got silver caps.
Hallelujah.
On his teeth. 9 teeth. Got silver caps on all 9 of them. And we went back to the school that year, and they looked at his teeth and said, who done that? He said, Jesus did. Jesus.
Praise God.
No, Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord. Let not your hearts be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. For in my Father's house there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go and prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself. For where I am, there you may be also. A shepherd, when he got his flock, he builds a little house, a little stall on the side of his house. And whenever the winter or the bad weather comes in, he brings his little lambs to him, to his house. So they're in his house forever and ever.
Praise God.
Thank you, Jimmy. Notice you can come close with some prayer, please, sir.
Father, we come before you today thanking you that you are a great God, Lord, and you are a protector and you are a creator, Lord. You're the provider of all things. And Father, as we look about in our life and in our nation, Lord, we just come to one point, and that's we're desperate for you, Lord, to come into our lives and to save us. Father, we know you do your best work in desperate situations. We read it in your word, Lord. We heard it in the testimony this morning. And we ask you to come in, Father, and move lives. Lord, those, everyone that's listening in this morning, Father, that they would be touched and drawn closer to you. And any, Lord, that don't know you, that today would be the day of salvation. Father, today would be the day that many across this city, Lord, would enter into relationship with Jesus Christ, realizing it's not about religion, Lord, it's about a relationship. And Father, we just ask you to have your way in our lives, Lord, and encourage us, Father, help us to be the mighty men and women of God and of Jesus Christ that you've created us to be. And Father, we thank you for this time this morning. We thank you for the good word that was brought. And we just lift all this up to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
That's the end of the Bible class this morning.